one seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere filling the air. Oh, how they come raising the sound, or hailing the hill, telling their tale. Gaily they ring while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here.
Ding, ding, dong, that little song. With joyful ring, the carol on.
Ding, dong,
ding, dong.
One seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere filling the air. Oh, how they pound, raising the sound, or hill and dale telling the tale. Gaily they ring while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here.
Ding, dong, ding, dong, that is a song.
Ding,
joyful ring, all caroling.
Ding, dong, ding,
ding. On they sound, on without end, their joyful tone to every home.
Ding, dong, ding, dong.
Thank you. Yes, welcome to our Christmas Eve candlelight and communion celebration, our Lord and Savior's birth. We gather tonight as we gather every year and as Christians gather all around the world to sing and celebrate and pray. And so we will do that tonight. And of course, all of our marvelously talented people have got us a great beginning, haven't they? Isn't that wonderful? So, okay, whatever you say, are we ready?
Thank you.
this Christmas Eve, may the grace that is Jesus Christ, the Son of God in Bethlehem's manger, the love of God who gives his Son this night, and the Holy Spirit who fills our hearts with the love of Christ, be with each of you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have filled us with the new light of the Word who became flesh and lived among us. Let the light of our faith shine in all that we do through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first lesson is a reading from Isaiah, the 9th chapter. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
The second lesson is a reading from Titus, the second chapter. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. Here ends the reading.
Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the second chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Creator and our Redeemer. Lord, take our eyes and see through them, our lips and speak through them. Take our hands and work through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire. Amen. Have you noticed the pronounced hush that attends the reading of St. Luke's nativity story on Christmas Eve? There is just a deepening of silence that normally accompanies the reading of Scripture, an increased attentiveness, an air of heightened expectation. Perhaps it's the solemnity of this evening. As we gather to light candles to celebrate the birth of the Christ child, perhaps it's the weight of tradition, aware that we listen to passages Christians have heard for centuries. But perhaps it's also the breathtakingly simple yet surprisingly powerful story of a young girl giving birth to her first child, attended only by shepherds and stable animals, but heralded by angels. By all rights, of course, it's a story that should not even be noticed, let alone be told over and over and over thousands of years. After all, countless young women gave birth that night, and we remember none of them. Interestingly, the smallness of Mary's story is underscored by Luke's narrative setting. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus. While Quirinius was governor, emperors and governors, they are the apt subjects for dramatic narratives. Unwed teenage mothers and their vulnerable babies are not. Yet Luke locates this simple story amid the powers and principalities of the age to make a claim. The child born to this young mother will change the course of history, and the fates of leaders and common folk alike hang in the balance of his destiny. I suspect that on one level, we've forgotten just how bold, if not downright outlandish, Luke's claim is. So accustomed to the slow and graceful reading of this passage, we may miss the irony of the setting of a newborn beside emperor, as if the two could possibly have anything to do with one another. At a deeper level, however, I have a hunch that we do recognize something of the absolute, even absurd, vulnerability of Mary and her child. And their very vulnerability may be a large part of what touches us and moves us. Few of us, after all, have much experience with anything miraculous, be it the relatively small scale of turning water into wine, or the grand event of resurrection that this humble beginning will lead to. Yet the vulnerability of a newborn, the fear and hope bundled together in the heart of a mother, these are things we have felt for real. How many among those who will gather around the world this Christmas Eve are coming with trepidation about a beleaguered nation, about the loss of a loved one, about a faltering relationship? How many come overshadowed by illness or filled with the foreboding of the safety of a loved one serving abroad? How many come weighed down, caring for a disabled child or an elderly parent? The plain truth of the matter is that each of us, and all of us, whether we dress in our holiday best or not, have been indelibly marked by the everyday hardships of life, and so are well acquainted with the sheer frailty of the unlikely lead characters in Luke's story. We instinctively feel for them, and each Christmas, we are all at the same time surprised, humbled, and encouraged to hear the promise that God is at work through them for us. In this respect, perhaps we're like the shepherds called from their fields. At the bottom of the socioeconomic world of the first century, the shepherds have no right, no expectation, no hope. No hope in the world of being touched by God. Little wonder then that they are terrified by the appearance of the heavenly host. It isn't too much to wonder if maybe they obey only because they can think of no other response to the angelic summons. Let us go, indeed. And so they run to the stable. They stumble upon the tender, or is it meager, scene. The mother and child, and wonder what on heaven or earth they have seen. They tell others what they've seen. What else can you do when you've been touched by God? And all are amazed at what happened. Here is the Christmas promise in a nutshell. God deigns to dwell, not with the high and mighty, but with the lowly, the unexpected, those considered nothing by the world. And here, amid the weakness and vulnerability of human birth, God makes God's intention for humanity known to the world. God is love, John writes. And Luke here portrays that love made manifest as God takes human form. The infinite becomes finite. That which is imperishable becomes perishable. The genius of Luke's story is that he portrays all this through the simple, sympathetic, everyday characters of a young mother and common shepherds. If God can work in and through such ordinary people, we are bid to wonder, perhaps God can work in and through us. Luke wants us, I think, to make sure we realize that it is not just human flesh in general that God takes on in Christ by way of this birth. It is our history and our very lives to which God is committed. So, if there is only one thing that we hear this Christmas Eve, it should be that this story of long ago is not only about angels and shepherds, a mother and her newborn. It's also about us. All of us gathered amid the candles and readings and carols and prayers. God came at Christmas for us, that we might have hope and courage amid the dark and dangerous times and places in our lives. This, in the end, is why we gather, so that just as God entered our world and came into our history so long ago through the Word made flesh, God might also enter our lives even now through the Word proclaimed in Scripture and song and sermon. No wonder we grow quiet.
joining our voices with all in heaven and on earth, praising the Word made flesh in Jesus. Let us pray for the world to which Christ comes, the church whom Christ calls, and all people in need whom Christ loves. Wonderful Counselor, in the fullness of time you became one of us, and your wisdom from on high came down to make a home among us. On this holy night, establish and uphold our world with your justice and righteousness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Mighty God, when the time had been fulfilled, you came down from heaven and became one with your creation by taking on our humanity. On this holy night, enable and empower your church to embrace your beloved humanity in its many and varied expressions. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Everlasting Father, when all was in readiness, you became flesh and blood to heal and redeem the world. On this holy night, may the light of Christ banish the darkness of war and global strife, that the nations may rejoice in your light. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prince of Peace, at the moment of your birth, the night sky rang out with the song of angels. On this holy night, preserve the earth, sea, and skies, the forest, fish, and fields, that peace on earth might extend to every living creature. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Word of life, on the night of your birth, you hallowed all time and all flesh. On this holy night, expand the vision of this faith community to recognize and welcome your holy face in every human being, and acknowledge your sacred fingerprint on every living thing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God with us, in every time and place, the voices of saints and angels together proclaim the good news of great joy, which is for all people. Blend our voices with theirs, and at the last day, assemble us all around your heavenly throne to forever sing a joyful song to you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Come down to us, O God, and make your home with us, in us, and through us. For the sake of the one whose birth the angels sang and the shepherds proclaimed, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts. With them we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth,
blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. chair right beside her. May the body and blood of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Thank you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen.